life signs. Population approximately 9 billion. All Borg.
How?
They must have done it in the past. They went back and assimilated Earth, changed history.
But if they changed history, why are we still here?
The temporal wake must have somehow protected us from the changes in the timeline. Sir, the vortex is collapsing.
Hold your course, Mr. Hawk. I must follow them back. Repair whatever damage they've done.
It was an extraordinary bit of Star Trek First Contact. It was the bit where the vortexes are falling. My guest today knows all about falling vortexes. His name is Patrick Stewart. He is the Shakespearean actor who boldly went where no other had gone before. He is the sexiest chrome dome in Hollywood, and he's here.
Yes!
Thank you. No, don't clap. Just throw money.
You don't need it, or I would.
One always needs it.
Chocolate
one
money.
One cannot be too rich or too thin, as somebody once said.
Well, I'm taking that very personally and hate you immediately on sight. Now, yesterday I had the great good fortune to bump into your director, Jonathan, and he said, as a message from him, I should ask you to do the entire interview kneeling. Why
yes.
is that funny? That was a cryptic message.
Because Jonathan broke the ice as a director on our series and allowed me to persuade the producers that I could direct also, and so I directed half a dozen episodes. There was one famous episode, because we work very fast in television, I'm sure I don't have to explain that to you, when in a particular shot, so that I didn't have to do a second setup with the camera, it required asking Jonathan if he would play a scene on his knees. Well, he did. He accommodated me, but I've always felt that at some point the price will have to be paid and I will have to do something equally odd for him.
I would imagine this is a cryptic message to you to say watch out. Tell us about this film. The villain is an old favourite.
Well, hardly favourite, although it's been, I suppose, the most popular villain the Next Generation ever had. The Borg. They are a half-mechanical, half-human race of creatures, implacably unpleasant, irresolutely irrational. You couldn't, for example, sit down and have a cup of tea with one of them and say, let's just talk through these problems. I'm sure we can come to some kind of happy compromise. That's not the way that you can reason with the Borg. They simply trample everything that's ahead of them, and it makes them a difficult foe to deal with. They're hard to destroy also because they can shift their nature so that you find one way to destroy them and then they can overcome it immediately.
And had not your character been captured
once
by a Borg, so
yes.
you remain a bit Borgified.
Absolutely.
A sort of
yes.
closet Borgified.
If you want to zoom in really tightly,
yeah, yeah.
just now, you'll see
Let's
those.
Zoom, go on.
Yeah, that's a technical filming term.
Just try zooming quick.
You'll see where those Borg implants have been. Get them?
See? There
Actually,
you go.
Those were pores in my nose.
So does that mean that you have a sneaking kind of sympathy for and with the Borg?
Empathy rather than sympathy.
Right.
But it also means that I hear their voices in my head, as you'll see in this movie, but that I have a personal crusade against them. And what happens in this film is that Picard is no longer just representing humanity in his attempt to overcome the Borg, but there is a personal element of revenge about it too, because they harmed him in the past.
And they're a very, very sexy Borg queen.
Oh.
Gorgeous.
Yes, erotic, sensual. Cool. Finger-licking good, if
God.
I could use that
I
phrase.
Don't think you better, no.
Played by Alice Krieger, a fabulous actress and a very sexy woman in her own right. But here she is an alien creature, and despite the tubes and whatnots coming out of her head, she manages, I think, to be one of the most sensual images that I've ever seen on a film.
Does this screen. Mean that you used to be a Trekkie in a past existence? I mean, were you a fan yourself?
No, never. In fact, when I was first offered this job now, almost a decade ago, I had to ask my children what it all meant. I didn't understand. I'm a little bit more familiar now than I was then, but no, never a fan.
Is it true that you're fluent in Klingon?
Well, I have been known to eat gach, and they do occasionally say kapla. I'm really sorry, can I wipe that off?
Yeah. They say that Americans in some universities offer degrees in Klingon, that you can buy Klingon Scrabble.
That is possible, although I cannot imagine you're ever going to get too rich marketing Klingon Scrabble. I think it's a fairly kind of elitist sort of game. No, I don't think there are any courses in Klingon. Although, seriously, if we can be serious, just for a moment, the world of Star Trek has in fact affected all kinds of areas of the academy, certainly business studies, literature, mythology, and so forth. It is actually taught as a part of a structured set of courses.
And as a former actor with the Royal Shakespeare Company, does this seem to you to be the right way or the wrong way?
What?
The study of Star Trek and its mythology as a serious literary entity.
Yes, believe me, I think you could do far worse. We're really quite proud of the context, the content of a lot of our scripts, and the context too. We like to think at least they're grammatically correct.
And to boldly go, that's the worst split infinitive in history.
It's the one instance where it was misused, but then how can you explain the phrase becoming so incredibly popular and well known?
It's the split that does it, I think.
I think it is.
It is actually
Star Trek language has kind of infiltrated all aspects of popular speech.
You're seen as an enormously popular sex symbol. Women all over the world pant after you.
So they say.
Well, you must know it. I mean, I hear that wherever you go, improper suggestions are thrust at you.
Yes, I'm not too keen on your use of the word thrust, but
I thought it was a very apposite word, and I chose it carefully.
Yes, it does happen that things get a little warm sometimes.
And do you enjoy that?
I'm a little uncomfortable with it, really. I was always very shy around girls when I was young, around women. I did actually say the other day, it would be very nice if this had happened when I was 16.
You know? How old were you when you lost your hair originally?
Oh, I thought you were going to ask me something else.
I wasn't. I wouldn't even think of it. Wouldn't dream of it.
Dear, oh dear. Thank you.
What I was hoping was for a lovely message for slapheads from you saying it can happen. You can be a world-class sex symbol even if all your hair drops out.
Oh, most certainly you can. Gentlemen, ladies, if you're out there, if the ladies need any reassurance, look at Alice Krieger in Final Contact. Bald is beautiful no matter what sex you are.
Hey, I couldn't say fairer than that. Thank you very much, Patrick Stewart. And now over to Peter Smith for the final Big Breakfast News and Weather.